What am I doing wrong?
No.
Other than being on my phone like an asshole. I live up to my fake pervert rep.
So, are you a fake pervert? Is that your...
My rep is that I think when I play so many shows or parts in a row that I would imagine people think that's my real life. So I seem to be okay at playing like a skirt chaser, and because I did it on sort of on Just Shoot Me, then on Rules of Engagement, then in Grown Ups.
Yeah.
And so I remember when we did Grown Ups and Adam was talking about putting me in, he said, "This is, we're all married." And I go, "Oh, great." And he goes, "Well, you're not. We're going to have you as like hitting on everybody, even our daughters." I'm like, "Well, that's great." So because he's the boss, just put that anywhere. Because he's the boss, I have to go along with it. But I was trying to, you know, be De Niro, and I go, "I have all these other moves. I can do so much." And then we found after a little investigating, I can't do much else. So I just try to tweak that one to make it whatever, because it's sarcastic. That sort of delivery is what they know me for.
Maybe Tarantino can reinvent you.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind that.
You're not quite old enough yet to be reinvented, but...
I'm very close. but yeah, I mean, I comb my hair back, so that's my big reinvention. And I have a Fonzie jacket. That's about as far as I can go myself. But it is tough because when you think of comedies, like, people go, "Oh, there's a comedy out, you should do it." But to be cast in a comedy, it's sort of, you know this too, like, let's say it's a pie chart, they don't just send you a comedy, they send you a comedy if it's for a specific type of comedy. Like if it's broad, this guy gets it, if it's this, but if it's that sliver of like sarcastic, this, then they go to like a handful of people. Even then you don't get it for sure, but everyone's got their little niche. So, and in reality, you know, Will Smith will get the first crack at it, Sandler, you know, Owen Wilson, Vince Vaughn, Ferrell. So that's another thing, even in the movie world, which we're not talking about, but I'm sort of drifting into, is that's a tough challenge to, and that's why I write stuff. Mm. Because if I get a script, it's so beaten up because those 9 people aren't doing it, that there's a reason. So I either have to go in there and fix it myself and rewrite it, or start one from scratch. And the movies I've gotten made where I was the lead, Lost and Found, Joe Dirt, Dickie Roberts, I co-wrote. So that was the only way to get those going. It's very hard to do, you know, so.
And people probably don't think of you as having already been nominated for multiple Emmys for writing.
Yeah, even I forgot about it. Saturday Night Live, yeah, for writing.
3 times, I think.
Yeah, and I was trying to be on the show more, so I didn't really care about the writing. I've learned over the years how hard it is and how, what a valuable asset it is. And, you know, if someone would say, "I want to be an actor," I have friends, kids, or people that say, "I want to move out there." You know, no one's going to take no for an answer, but I would recommend against it unless you're some sort of triple threat. I mean, if I was on Saturday Night Live and I could even sing or play guitar, your odds are go up exponentially to be on the show. Adam could sing very well. He could play the guitar. I mean, he went on tour after a few years, not even a stand-up tour. He took a band and he was selling out 7,000 seaters. I thought, what is this, a trick? Like, you don't even have to do your jokes. He goes, "No, I do." Some funny songs, some Zeppelin. It's just like a fun party night. So that was great. He could always sing a song. He does in his movies. It really helps. He can write songs. His albums do very well. And if you're on SNL, every pitch, you know, they're like, "And then we're going to do this Christmas thing where everyone sings. Do you sing?" And I'm like, "Well," and they're like, "Okay, not you." And then you're out of the sketch. So
were you in the show? Was it most, I mean, because traditionally, oddly enough, I worked there before you got there.
Oh,
I'm older than you, I guess. But maybe I'm not. I think we're actually almost exactly the same age. No, I think we're actually the same age, okay. But by
no,
a few months.
No numbers, yeah.
Yeah. Happy. Anyway, but back when I was there, it was like you had to kind of write to get on the show, period.
Yeah.
There was no way to do it otherwise. But it seems like in your era that maybe there were so many guys writing that were interesting.
Well, when I got there, they hired me as a writer-performer, me and Rob Schneider, and I didn't even want that. I thought, oh, no, I don't know how to write. I just wrote my stand-up, which I didn't really consider writing. But when I got there, and writing a sketch format is completely different. You have to relearn, and no one's teaching you. You know, you walk there, and everyone shuts the door and goes, good luck. If you aren't here tomorrow, that's easier for me, because that means they have one less sketch to compete against. So no one's there to really help you and make your life easy. And it's not even their fault. It's just dog-eat-dog and the way it's set up. So I would try to write sketches. I'd make them 15 pages long. They'd go, what is this? I go, I don't know. Like, tell me. But you just have to learn by looking at a sketch, looking at your own, going, this is too long. Oh, they only have two sets. Okay, well, making sure the right cast are in it. But if I wrote for myself, they wouldn't let it on. They go, write for Dana, write for Mike Myers, write for anyone else. Farley was written for a lot. If you have a lot of moves, you get written for. I didn't have tons of characters. I didn't have tons of impressions. SNL probably wasn't even the best place for me. I was very lucky to get away with just snarky attitude. Took a while to ramp up to that, but then at least I got like sort of a niche. And I was always jealous because they'd write for Chris. They'd write for a lot of the people that were really good. And so I'd have to try to write for myself.
So when you started even before that, I mean, did you start out to be a stand-up? Did you start out to be an actor? Did you?
I just started out to get some attention, I guess. I mean, everyone left my high school, and I was at community college. Not because I wasn't smart. Oh, no, it was, because you weren't smart. This just in, you weren't that smart. So I went to community college, and then I'd never been in this position where I had all my friends around and then they're gone. Like, I have friends around in grade school, ride bikes. Every day in high school is so fun because they're there at night, they're there in the day. Everyone scatters. I went to a comedy club just to watch. And I was like, wow, if I could do this, this is unbelievable. Never thought I could do it. I saw a guy do an hour. I thought, is he making this up? Is he just talking? It's unbelievable. So I went home, scribble. And I think I wrote, I bought a new car. Well, it's not really new. It's an old UPS truck. I got it so I can park wherever I want to. Because back then they were, gets a little laugh. So I went out there and tried it. And that was learning how to write and perform. And then getting on SNL was really lucky. But then I started from scratch again.
So was your attitude, was it that your rhythm? Because, I mean, you definitely have a thing.
Yeah.
Was that there in high school? Was that there from the beginning, or was that something you developed?
I developed it. I mean, I was a little shrimpy, and I had some personality, but I think I was surviving with just sort of commenting jokes under my breath. And that was more from thinking they weren't good. So I would just say them quietly, and then if they got a laugh, I'd be happy. If they didn't, I'd be like, it wasn't really even a joke. I wasn't trying. And that's sort of exactly what I still do. So even in grown-ups, everyone's talking and I'll try to throw something in quickly. And that's my thing to add to grown-ups. You know what I mean? Everyone's got their move and everyone's good at one thing. So I think that's what I'm used for there, which is great. I love that stuff. I like it more thrown away. And that's why I think next, I did this comedy special sort of to say I've been on sitcoms for years and years and I love them, but this is more my sense of humor that I'm writing. And get some other writers or people rally together, so if I do a show that's a little rougher on the edges, this is the tone I like.
Well, you definitely seem like more of a adult in this than
yeah.
you did.
And I did have a special before, but it was a while ago. It was over 10 years ago, I guess. So that was my humor then. I still like those jokes, but then this is it now, and I wasn't going to do one because, you know, they always talk about burning off material. It's a big discussion among comedians. Why haven't you done one? Why won't you do one? And I think what happened is when I did my HBO one, such a huge chunk of the comedy world saw it, and the general public. HBO special was twice a year. It was a big deal. Now there's HBO, Comedy Central, Netflix, Stars, Epics, and then your own. You put it on your own website. So I thought, and Comedy Central takes some commercials out so that you're 20 minutes of your act isn't used.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought, well, not everyone's going to see it anymore. And if they do it, they'll see pieces of it, you know, on reruns. So I can get away with, like, not throwing away the whole act. I can do the 20 minutes they haven't seen, and then I can work in new stuff as I go. But I it's not that scary anymore as it was. Now Chris Rock, Dennis Miller, they still throw it all away.
Mm.
Throwing it all away. but I don't, because I'm too scared. I need those tentpole jokes. When people come to Vegas and they're paying $80 or whatever it is to see me, I can't screw around, you know. I need to go walk out, be funny until I get off. I can't go, hey, I'm going to try some, this is what I was thinking about in the shower. They're like, dude, I could be at Britney.
So do you do that? I mean, do you go out to small clubs and work those jokes out? Or you have a set that you kind
of... I sort of know in my head what will work at this point, but I also got to go try them. And the wording is so important. That's where the writing comes in. Like, I will try to tape it and listen to it, which I bug the improv about getting those tapes, because if I force myself to watch it, I can do my whole set and I go, I need to listen to this 30 seconds because I said a new joke and I said it perfectly right. And one night I do it wrong, one night I do it wrong, and then I say it right, and I just have to memorize it that way, because it's such lightning in a bottle to get these jokes to work. Mm-hmm. You have to really say it in the perfect order. And then the next day you kind of remember it and it doesn't work and you go, I didn't say it like last night. I don't know why it worked. And then you figure it out and then you lock that into your act the way it is. It's very complicated.
In some ways it's almost like dialogue. It's almost like you're doing dialogue with yourself.
Yeah.
Because you're setting yourself up for the kind of, that thing you're telling a joke on yourself, you know, throwaway at the end of it is like really the punchline.
Yeah, I'm trying to also keep it loose and just talk, and just talk the idea I thought of and see if there's anything there. And then the next night, I go, it's too long, and then I got to trim it. And then I'm taping on, all right, and then you're right, those throwaway jokes at the end of them are sometimes 90% of the funny.
Yeah.
And if you have a good set, you start tagging it with more and more because they're laughing, so you just keep talking, whatever comes to mind. The best is when you have like a good joke and like 9 after tags to it, and then you play a crummy venue and they don't laugh, and you're in like your third tag going, they're not even laughing anymore. Do I really need to go through all 9 of these? That was made for the audience that was still laughing. And you get spooked. You go, oh my God, this one's dead already. You start skimming your act, jumping ahead, moving things around, because you go, this one, I can look down at my notes because I have a little cheat sheet, you know, like a set list. And then I can look down and go, this will not work. I can tell in 1 second, too dirty for this crowd, too long. They're not going to pay attention to this one. I jump to ones that are tent poles that'll work. And then once you get them on my side, I go back and pick up the other ones. It's tricky. The more I don't want to do it anymore. It's just so exhausting.
Well, you don't have the I suck thing. I mean, there's some comedians who do that joke bomb, then they try to get a laugh out of that. That's not one of your...
Well, I've learned over the years that I used to do that, and I go, well, that one worked better in the shower. And I would do that, or I go, this is a tough crowd, you know. But I've heard from audience members that go, I didn't know it was going badly until you said it. Because if they've never been in a comedy show, or they weren't there the night before when it was killing, they think this is the level of laughs you get. So they go, I'm not a big laugher. I'm smiling going, this is funny. And then you just said, I'm eating it. What's wrong with you people? And they go, oh, and then they tighten up going, are we not laughing? Because until like one guy busts it out a big laugh, people get intimidated. They don't want to be like, rah, 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 rah. Because sometimes the comedian will be like, hey, what do you sit on your keys? But you can't make, that's a pretty good one. You can't make fun of a laugher when they don't laugh.
Right.
Unless it's, you know, Maria Menounos or something. They go, or however she laughs. Then I'd go, all right, you step out.
It's a little scary that we know how Maria Menounos laughs now.
I know. It is funny, and I don't think there's a fix.
When are you starting your reality show?
I sort of want to do a reality show, just a curb type of show. That would be a next funny move. Those shows are always funny, like Larry Sanders, and they're so hard to do, but I feel like it's time to try something like that.
Because Maria Menounos has I don't know if you've seen her reality show.
No, I was skimming over that, yeah. No, I mean, it's, you know, that's different. That's her family, and we're Greek, and we're around the table, and I sound condescending, but I'm just saying that's like a reality show. I would try to do the fake reality show where we're trying to make it really funny. They will be accidentally funny in the way they do their life, but I would do a fake version of my life.
Lovitz lives in the basement. And
and mine or hers or both?
Yep.
It would be believable in both. Hello. Send some food down. That's lovely.
So do you like... Does the... I'm joking, sorry. Does the pleasure you get out of the stand-up similar to the pleasure you get out of doing the sitcoms and the movies, or...?
Yeah, more. I mean, stand-up is always hard, and I always get scared before I go on in Vegas or get frustrated or anxiety, because I'm like, why am I still doing this? Because it's still hard to go out and stand there for an hour. No pee breaks, no, you know. We get to be so lazy, like when you do a sitcom, and I'm like, all right, I need a 5. I'm walking up to go to the bathroom. Oh, I'm going to grab something to eat. Because it's such a slow day, it doesn't matter. When there's an hour, it sounds like nothing, but you can't take a call. You can't stop talking. You can't have a cough. You can't have a headache. You just have to go plow through, be funny, be very hyper aware of everything going on. Someone stands up, you have to mention it. And it's sort of taxing because you're not used to that in everyday life. You check out, people talk, you zone out. This is like, and you have to remember every word of your act, sort of like a play, in order and with the right intonations. And if you do them wrong, or if you space, like I've been in the middle of jokes. I was on a TV show and I couldn't remember the end of my joke. I was like, I went to the mall yesterday and yeah, then I cruised home. Like, I don't even know what I'm talking about. I'm like, what is this joke? I've done it 50 times. I can't think of where it's going. Mm. I did a Costco bit about my mom. I've done it forever. I got in the middle at one sort of important gig, blanked, just what's happening? I'm skipping a full chunk, I can tell. I go, this joke doesn't make sense anymore. And I finish it, doesn't get a laugh, and then later they go, you didn't do the whole middle. I go, oh my God, that's right. I just did the beginning and the end, and people are like, Head scratcher. I want to be like Britney, just lazily fake dancer and act like slave for you. You know, she's like eating Cheetos and $200 a ticket. And backup dancers are like nailing it. She's like, slave. You know the words.
Maybe that's what you need is backup comedians.
I do. My jokes are clanking. This guy's will kill behind me.
So what is this particular show, the particular Comedy Central show, is that half of your act that you've been doing, or
well,
is that, or
that's
do you
interesting.
Retire
I
now?
I did my HBO one, I said over 10 years ago, and so I probably rotated maybe almost a full hour in between, you know what I mean? And then that went away. And then that's why I might as well put it down, because it's already changing since I shot it. So might as well get people to see it, might as well get out there. And I've gotten great response. So I hear from comedians, which is great, like ones I haven't seen in years, ones I did the road with. People I, you know, Amy Schumer, who's new to me, like I met her a year ago, and Whitney Cummings, and, you know, Chris Rock. People I know a little bit, people I don't know as well. But to get people out of the woodwork telling me which jokes, these things, what chunks they liked, means a lot. It just makes you feel like back in the mix, because I think people that come to see me in Vegas are just in the hotel or they're nearby and go, hey, David Spade, I've seen him on 10 shows and 6 commercials. Let me go see what. But they don't really know what my stand-up would be. Mm-hmm. Kevin James sort of has that. Rob Schneider, like, we all still do stand-up. Tosh, they do it and they don't really know what it would be. Mm-hmm. Kevin James kills. He's a great act. And people go see him and they're like, great. People see me and they go, oh, I was surprised. I didn't even know what it would be like. It's not too dirty. It's not that bad. It's just, I know that how far I can push it, because Chris Rock can be dirty. He's known for it. Mm-hmm. If I have a really dirty joke, I try to give it to him, because they don't buy it from me. I know how far I can go before they shut up. It's so weird. They're so ingrained with me on TV that they're not accepting of that really dirty stuff.
So do you want that? I mean, do you want to push that?
I mean,
that,
I think of dirty stuff... not just like crude jokes, but hopefully clever, but my sense of humor, but it's a little dark, and they just can't. So I get the business that that's not for my audience, but I will try to get it out there somewhere. I'll do it on Funny or Die or something.
But is there like a trap of having the audience, of having the rep and the fame and people having expectations of what your boundaries are?
I mean, it's a trap in the way that those are fake problems where, you know, one trap was at SNL, you need a voice. They're like, who are you? Mm-hmm. You know, Chris Rock, are you the angry black guy? Farley, you're the fat guy that falls down. Sandler, you sing songs and act goofy. Spade, what are you? Like, that's so hard to get. Because you go, Tim Meadows. I remember Dennis Miller goes, you're not even an angry black guy. You're just a black guy. So, what's your angle? And that's sort of true, because I was like, what's my angle? And it came out through knowing people and going, I remember Hollywood Minute, I was just reading People magazine at the table and just talking out loud. About like Michael Bolton going, ah, you got your hair long in the back, but we all know what's going on top. It's called Rogaine. Let's look into it, folks. And they were like, why don't you just do something like that? And that sort of turned into that. Now, then Lauren says do it a lot. Now I'm a whore to get on the show because I haven't been getting on. And this is the boss saying, the guy, it's like my dad saying, you've ignored me for 3 years, now you're putting me on. And then 2 weeks later, Hollywood Minute this week. I'm like, sure. So I didn't care who I was hurting feelings. I was like, this is my time or I'm going to get fired. Mm. So I do it. And then the trick is you're a one-trick pony. It's like, you're the sarcastic guy. What else? So now I'm spending the next 2 years trying to get away from that. And that's what happens. Like, Chris Farley wanted to be more dramatic. Mm. Sandler works with Paul Thomas Anderson. Like, you get your
Bill
thing.
Murray doing
Razor's Edge.
Razor's Edge.
The infamous misstep, or was it? We don't know. But
well, now he's figured it out.
At
now
the
got
time,
older
and, yeah. People are like, no. But yeah, you always you sort of owe it to yourself to do what makes you happy. But I have a crowd, however big or small, that likes something. So I can't expect them like. People go, why don't you do more dramatic stuff? Because your comedy is pretty straight. Like, it's pretty delivered normally. So if there's one of those scary movies like Cloverfield or something, there's always one guy that's acting, but he's also being funny, you know?
Right.
I was like, I would do that, but there's no demand. Like, they don't even consider that. So I would either have to make that happen on my own or work harder doing that. But
well, do you have the urge to play Shakespeare or to
no.
do something really dramatic? Or?
Jim Carrey, I think his dad told him, at one point, he goes, you're probably the best comedian out there. So why do you want to be one of the top 70 dramatic actors? And he was like, yeah, he didn't listen. But but he is good. Yeah. You know, he's good at that. Truman Show was a big deal. I mean, that was great for him. You don't always get those movies. Robin Williams did it. I would like to do it at some point if it's something cool. And Paul Thomas Anderson wants to do it. Me and Joaquin Phoenix, season 2, True Detective. Look for it.
I like
that. Oh my God,
I'm
giving it all away. Yeah.
But they kind of built Shoot Me Around You to a great extent.
Yeah.
And that character.
Yeah, I got lucky in that respect. It was added after the pilot was shot. So we had to reshoot me into it. And then I got lucky because I gambled on being the fifth lead, but I saw everybody and I said, everyone's very good, but they don't have like a me type of humor or look or anything. And if they would roll with that and write for me, all you have to do is get 3 jokes right. And then the writers go, throw it his way, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Give him something to do, because at least when they give you something to lift, you can handle it. And then they want to make their life easier, so they start dishing you jokes, and it makes them look good. So that worked there. Rules of Engagement was sort of a similar character, but the older version. But that was fun too, you know? I would do another sitcom, I'm sure. I just... right now I want to try something a little weirder, but running out of time, you know.
You're not running out of time. Do you feel like you're running out of time?
Clock is ticking.
Do you ever just want to retire and get out of it, or can you
imagine?
No,
because I get too fidgety. I like it too much. I like coming up with ideas. Even for stand-up, it's a great way I can just come up with ideas and do little things. So I like it. And I like sort of a job to go to, and then you appreciate the time off. I have a lot of time off now, so... I'm writing a book, so it's like in the middle of the day. King.
Have you got one of those still?
From the 40s.
Yeah.
Hat that says press. So I will, yeah, on my computer I'm literally like, cha, Enter. 9. Backspace. 1. How do I do margins? You know, it's like that's how long it's going to take me. So.
And does the fame part of it pleasant or unpleasant? I mean, they're all kind. I read your IMDb page, and they're all kind of like, this thing happened and that thing happened. Your assistant taser, all this stuff.
Well,
and, like,
the tour bus comes to my house every 20 minutes, so I have. I'm not super friendly to them, to be honest. I wave, but I don't. They go, come on the bus. I'm not that guy. I'm not bringing him cookies, because when you have someone break in your house. I don't want to give 200 new people a day my address, and that feels weird. They do that for me. Mm-hmm. And then TMZ and those places find out where your habits are, like where I eat breakfast now, they are there when I come out in the morning. Who wants to do that at 8:45? You know, like, David, Tracy Morgan, is he okay? I'm like, I don't know, I can't think. Your hair's all wet, and you're like coming out with your paper. David. Scrambled or fried? Talk about the eggs.
Do you hate? I mean, is that the price one pays for success ultimately these days, or it must have changed over the last?
I mean, that's
years.
That's under the guise of the special My Fake Problems, because no one else would care. They're like, I can't pay my rent.
So you really can't.
You get a TMZ guy that wants to make you more famous. So you can't really say that to anyone. You just go, oh well. And it's not really a horrible thing. It's just sort of navigating through. I'm sort of medium famous, so I used to think, you know, everyone that saw me, I was like excited because they're like, oh, I know that guy. And I thought they all liked me. But the other new trick is that it doesn't mean they like you. They just know you. They're like, hey, that guy's in that show. He sucks. I'm like, oh, that wasn't what I was expecting. You're supposed to think I'm great. So that's hard. So it always humbles you. If you ever get cocky, just get on Twitter or... get on anything where people tell you that you're horrible.
So when you were way back when you were getting out of, when you were in community college, mm-hmm. and you thought about what this all, did you ever think about what this all might lead to? Did it, have you had a
No, it was
kind
always
of plan,
the biggest goal was, when I started stand-up, was like, I was getting $20 a set. I thought if I could make four sets a week, that would be 100 or 80. If I could do that every week, if I could pay my rent, and maybe a crummy car payment. The ultimate goal was to not borrow from people. So if I can cover myself, then no one can rag on me for what I want to do. So once I started making about, you know, 1,500 a month or something, 1,000 a month I could get by, then I was like golden. I said, that's it. That's what I want. I can do this now. And then anything above that was great. So listen, I don't want to go back to that price, but it worked then. Now it wouldn't work as good.
But your fake problems really are your fake problems to you.
I have real stuff, but we won't talk about it in this. Maybe in the next edition, we'll sit down here like a therapist. But yeah, I mean, overall, things are going fine. So I try to look at it that way and say, you get bummed about stuff, but you go, it's fine. Overall, it's all right. I thought I'd cry during this interview. I guess it's not going to happen.
Sad clown. No. Yeah. we did have a year where a lot of people cried. But.
Well, that's because they're winning Oscars. I'd start crying, too. I'd be excited.